Good morning. I welcome you as we gather on this second Sunday of Lent and continue our sacred journey to Jerusalem. I welcome those who may be worshiping with us for the first time, both here in the sanctuary and online. Also extend a very special welcome to Irina Ferretti. There you are. And we are so humbled that you have come to share your story with us today. I thank Daniela Gutierrez, who is our tech person this morning. The altar flowers this morning have been given in loving memory of Priscilla DeGroote and Robert Loud, parents of Ann Duggan. Flowers are given by Ann and her husband, Jerry. And I'm going to call upon our Minister of Discipleship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The children will be going to Fellowship Hall today after the children's message, where they will be making pins and keychains that will be available at coffee hour for a donation of your choice. Also in Fellowship Hall, there are envelopes for the children for their own little offerings that they can either return today or bring back in the future so that they can also participate in the special offering for Ukraine. Next week, we have Bible Quest in the afternoon for third graders, and the following Sunday is Bible Sunday, so please join us as we celebrate our third graders and older as they receive their Bibles. Thank you.
A few additional announcements. The Outreach Ministry is conducting its diaper drive this month. Whole list of items that are needed in the Hilltop News, in addition to diapers, baby formula, baby food, and other items will be donated to neighbors in need in Lawrence. There is a box, actually several boxes, the response has been wonderful, up in Fellowship Hall. Up in Fellowship Hall, you'll also see a sign-up sheet for the lobster bisque to go. We do this every Friday during Lent. If you would like to place an order to pick up on Friday between 10 and noon, the sign-up sheet is on the right as you go into the hall. In the Hilltop News, there is a link, which is now correct. Third time, never fail. And this is for the Easter Vigil. It is held in the chapel from Good Friday through Easter morning. It's a time of prayer and meditation. The Christ candle will be there, and we will keep watch over it. If you would like to sign up for that, you can do so in this week's Hilltop News. This morning, we will have a special offering for the people of Ukraine. It will be going to the International Red Cross. There are envelopes in the pews for everyone to use. And if you do by check, just make it out to the church and put in the memo line, Ukraine. At this time, I'd like to actually call Irina forward. I do that all the time. So, Irina, we do want to thank you for being here this morning. We have in our church a group of people who are part of what we refer to as our prayer shawl ministry, and they knit prayer shawls, and so we would like you to have this one.
Thank you so much. Appreciate that.
God bless.
Thank you.
Are there any other announcements? If not, then let us draw near to the throne of grace as we give thanks for the love that is from everlasting to everlasting.
Our world, our Lord, is sacred.
please join me in the call to worship. God calls us here to be faithful witnesses of the child who was born in Bethlehem.
God calls us here to be faithful witnesses of the prophet who was crucified in Jerusalem.
God calls us here to be faithful witnesses of the Christ who triumphantly rose from the dead.
And promises to all who trust in him forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace.
Courage in the struggle for justice and peace.
His presence in trials and rejoicing.
And eternal life in his kingdom, which has no end.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Join me in the prayer of St. Francis. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me so love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please be seated. So our order of worship is a little different this morning, and I'm going to begin the children's message by saying that this past week I found myself thinking a lot about this rope. And the reason why I began thinking about rope is if you look at that picture, you see that a big piece of rope is actually made up of lots of little pieces of rope. And I have this here. I took a picture of it because it's going to be hard for you to see it, but that's what's up on the screen. And as you can see, there are a number of strands in this rope. And when I take just one of the strands, I can break it easily. But you start putting all the strands together, Gail, you want to help me? I'm not as young as I used to be. Let's see if we can break this. Oh, we did. Now, you stay right there, because what we're going to do now, actually, I don't, all right. Hey, about that is, all right. Now I've got three strands, and there's no way, I don't want you to go flying into the piano. And the reason why I did this is because the more strands you put together, the more it becomes impossible to break the rope. And love is like that. One person loving can do a little, but a whole lot of people loving can do amazing things, and that love cannot be broken. That's what we're doing here this morning. We're bringing all of our love together for Irina and all of the Ukrainian people. And we're saying we will not let hate have the final word. We're going to love, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure that evil doesn't win. Remember, love conquers all. Love is greater than anything in the entire world. And so right now, the people of the Ukraine need your love, my love, all of our love. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you that you have given us hearts full of love. And we want to be like Jesus. We want to love one another. And we know, God, that there are some people in the world that do not love. Help us to make our love stronger than anyone's hate. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Please join me in the responsive call to prayer. Draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. My sisters and brothers, let us take a moment to enter into this moment of sacred silence that we might be one with our God. Good people, are there prayers that you would like to lift up to the Lord this morning? As you reflect, I share a few. One, we pray for Brenda Sutherland. She was diagnosed with COVID this past week. Her symptoms are mild, so we are thankful for that. We ask that God's spirit of healing be upon her. Lord, in your goodness,
hear our prayer.
We also lift up in prayer Lauren McMullen's father, Stephen, who passed away. Actually, let me not say that. I'm not sure. He's in the ICU. And so we ask that God be with Lauren during this difficult time for her family. Lord, in your goodness,
hear our prayer.
We lift up in prayer Lauren Jenkins' friend, Iho Babko. We heard last week he has a father who is a doctor in the Ukraine. I believe Ihor is from Hungary. And right now his mother is sheltering 15 Ukrainian orphans in her basement. We lift up Ihor's family and all those in Europe and particularly along the borders with Ukraine who are opening their doors to the country and their hearts to the Ukrainian people. Lord, in your goodness, at this time, I want to do a special prayer for Ukraine. This is an update of one that we did when the war first started. And the response after each time I say, Lord, in your great mercy, is hear our prayer. Let us pray. God of swords that are made into plowshares and spears that are turned into pruning hooks, we lift up the ancient words of the prophet Isaiah as we weep with the Ukrainian people in their hour of great peril. Lord, in your great mercy, we pray for an end to the missile strikes and the long-range artillery and the sounds of air raid sirens. Lord, in your great mercy, we pray for the brave Ukrainian soldiers and people as they defend their country. Lord, in your great mercy, we pray for the women and children who have fled the fighting and are now living as refugees. Lord, in your great mercy, we also give thanks and pray for all the countries that have opened their borders as they will take in the refugees. Lord, in your great mercy, we also pray for all the courageous peacemakers across Russia who have condemned this shameful invasion and in doing so have risked arrest and persecution. Lord, in your great mercy, we confess, Holy One, that we have studied war for far too long. Let it be no more. Lord, in your great mercy, as we watch the unfolding shame that is being inflicted upon the people of the Ukraine, we know that you are a righteous judge and that the day will come when all who sow seeds of death and destruction and despair will stand before your heavenly throne and answer for their sins. Lord, in your great mercy, we pray this, God of all the nations and all the peoples of the earth, in the name of the Prince of Peace, who long ago wept when he said, "If only you knew the things that make for peace." Lord, in your great mercy. Amen. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. At this time, I would like to invite Irina to come forward. And before we begin, I'm going to say, Irina's nervous, aren't you?
Yes, very much.
She's not used to doing public speaking, and so I reassured her, don't worry, I'll make sure it goes okay. And if anything goes wrong, I'm telling you right now, it's my fault. But we thank you for being with us this morning, Irina, to tell us your story. And before we get into what's going on in Ukraine, maybe you can share a little bit about yourself. You were originally born in Ukraine and came to this country.
Yes. So I just want to greet everybody and thank you for having us. Dobrý den. My name is Irina Ferretti. This is my married name. And in Ukraine, if you would refer to me, it will sound like Kravchuk Irina Orestivna. Orestivna, it's usually my father's name. So in Ukraine, you call the girl or boy after their first name, you call their father's name. So that's my name in the passport. So my first name, and my father's name. That's how us Ukrainians always been raised and born. So yes, I raised and born in Ukraine. Yeah. I went to school there. I went to college there. So all my life and everything that I know, and since I was born, I always spoke pure Ukrainian language, of course with a dialect, because I was born in the west of Ukraine, and my grandparents were born on a Polish border, so we were considered as a Lemkos. So Ukrainian language was always influenced by English, so we all our own dialects. So, and Ukraine was always Ukraine to me, and that was my home country, it was my land, yeah. And this is heartbreaking what's going on right now. And of course you always hear about the struggles in different countries and everything, and you care about the people, but when it touches so close to the home, mm-hmm. it's just no words to describe.
And when did you come to this country?
I came to U.S. 21 years ago. So. And I made U.S. my country. I'm U.S. citizen now. I have two children that was born here, but they speak Ukrainian language. They been to Ukraine many times. They understand the culture, because every time we celebrate the Christmas, so the kids know that U.S. Christmas come first, and then we have Ukrainian Christmas. Then we have U.S. Easter, then we have Ukrainian Easter. So they can't wait for these double holidays, and they can't stop bragging about it. So like all their friends are just completely jealous. And because the presents run.
I'm jealous.
Trust me, me too.
And you met your husband, Raymond, in this country?
No, I met my husband in Hong Kong.
Oh.
Yes.
Okay.
I know, that's the big world, you know, it's just long story short, we've been both working there, he's in his business, I'm in my business, and we met in the new year.
So oh my goodness.
It's meant to be.
Yes, absolutely. But I think in the pictures you sent me, there were a couple pictures of the church from your hometown, and that was where you were married?
One of the churches, yes, because my city called Ternopil, it's in the west of Ukraine, and any city, Ternopil, city or village or whatever, we always have a churches. Churches is the mm-hmm. always in the center of the city. They always creating communities for the people and everything. So in the city where I was born, it's like almost each district, like they have a school and they have a church. So, and one of those churches that I send you the pictures is the oldest church. It's the beginning of the foundation of our city. Mm-hmm. That's the church that we get married.
And Ukrainian Orthodox is the religion?
Not main. Orthodox religion was there when we under Soviet Union. So because Soviet Union can, people in Ukraine was in generally very religious, so
yes.
They were Catholics.
Oh, okay.
So they were like Greek Catholics, Greek Orthodox Catholics, mm-hmm. but when it was Soviet Union, they brought the Orthodox Church into the Ukraine to control the people. Uh-huh. So the church was the main, like a base of controlling people uh-huh. and give their, you know, like, they tried any ways to control it, but church was one of them. So that's when this Orthodox church came. Later, it was changed. It was more become about religion. So that's why our city has, like, if you walk around each church, it's a different type of church. So we have, and recently, because we have a lot of students from Middle East and everything, so we even started to have the churches for them.
Yeah, mosques.
Exactly. So, yeah. And I know that the Russian leaders are saying that people have been persecuted for their language yeah. or religion or whatever in Ukraine. And I'm telling you from a first hand, it's completely, completely insane.
Absolutely. So. We have a picture of a map of Ukraine, and you can yeah. see it right there on the right with the arrow. And when I first looked at this, and I'm a big geography buff, but when I looked at that, I thought, my goodness, look at how big Russia is compared to Ukraine.
Russia has 145 million people, and they fight against 40 million people in Ukraine. And of those 40 million, it's literally, it's a lot of elderly, because our generation, the population right now, it's all older people, because younger people, because of all this that's going on, people leave, they go study, they go to work. So our country right now is mainly older population.
But we've been reading about a lot of Ukrainians going back to defend their country.
One of my cousins, he works for the Polish company, he drives the trucks. And when everything started, he was in Portugal driving his truck, the route, you know, with the supplies. And he came back. He came back a week ago, and this is it. You know, he's signing up. But
yeah. And this next picture shows where you grew up.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's called what?
Ternopil.
Uh-huh. And that's a region where you were from.
That's Ternopil, it's a city.
Oh, I
so
see.
So it is the city, and the region, it's Ternopilsky region as well, yes. Mm-hmm. I think right now you're showing the whole region, yes.
Yes, yeah. So you still have family in Ukraine. How many?
So trust me, it's very hard to count. Like, you have to really sit down and write it, but we did a preliminary count. It's like 30 plus family members, and believe or not, it's only me, the one from 30 plus that left the U.S., I mean, left the Ukraine.
Yeah.
All my family all stay in the same region. Yeah. Nobody left, we all settle in one place. Ukrainians in generally, we're not travelers. So we settle right next to each other. So my mom grew up in the village with four sisters. So all the sisters bought the homes around their mother's homes. So their children bought the homes around their mother's homes. So we're like, literally, we're just like in one area. Every time you walk on the street, everybody knows you. Everybody refers you to your mother's maiden name.
Uh-huh.
Because my father was from a little bit different region. So yeah. like, but it's just, you in the street, you in the store, whatever. Somebody gonna recognize you, or you're gonna recognize somebody. Yeah. So it's like, when you need to go somewhere and it's take you 30 minutes, just taking time and they can take an hour, because you're gonna 30 minutes you're gonna chat with the people on the street.
As you were saying that, it reminded me of an American television show, I'm sure everybody here will remember, called Cheers, and the tagline was, where everyone knows your name. And
exactly, yeah. That's the city, because again, I went to school there. School, it's the people. Schools here is a little different than in Ukraine. So if I enter preschool at age 6 with 30 kids in my class, that's what I'm going to, 12 years later, that's the same 12 kids going to be with me in the same class for 12 years. So they literally, you refer to them as a family. So the same in the college. In the college now, you have people coming from different regions of Ukraine. So your friendship spreads to the different parts of Ukraine.
And you have some pictures of family members?
Yeah.
I knew her name is Nadia.
Aunt Nadia. This is the youngest sister of my mom. And my grandparents had, my mom grew up on the farm. In Ukraine, it's always one child supposed to stay in a family house. So Nadia was the woman that decided to stay. Everybody else left, and she was the one that had to take care of the parents and the farm and everything. So that's where she settled. So that's family house. It means goes to her. Nobody, have any rights to it or whatever, because she's taking care of everything. Yeah. So these two children is mine. So when they came over, and of course, she wanted to show them the life in Ukraine, the simple one. So she was milking a cow, and my daughter's face, she was like, oh my God, is that comes from a cow? And right
Never
the
drank
cow,
milk again.
Exactly. And right next to the cow, it was a pigs. And and they had the lunch before that, so they had the pork. And my son is like, oh wow, this is nice. I said, like, yeah, you just eat the. He's like, what do you mean? I eat pork. I said, yeah, that comes from a pig. So a confusion was very big, but they had a great time.
I'm going to ask you to take a half step there. I just don't want to make sure that you're not off camera. And the next picture.
That's the city, and that's my niece, my sister's daughter, and that's two boy and a girl. That's mine. And the city is beautiful. If you just look at the roads,
yes.
It's all handmade. It's all over through the town. Mm. People made this like hundreds and hundreds of years ago, and those are the most strongest roads we ever have. So like they tried to change them to the pavements, and they did the little sections in the city, and people were furious about furious.
Tradition. So,
and this is basically the whole town.
It's like that road.
Just like that road, yes.
And the next picture?
So this is my nephews and nieces, and this is my parents' house in the village, and we had a little cookout. Uh-huh. Usually on Sundays, this is the time when you're not supposed to work. Ukrainians are working 24/7, trust me. I'm learning so hard not to do as much. But and then usually on Sunday, some of the house hosting like little get-together, so we start at noon, and people come and we eat, people, kids playing. So yeah, this is my nephews and nieces.
And the next picture. Oh, I put this one in here because I was fascinated by what they're doing. It looks like they're stringing berries.
That's how we grow up. So I took the kids because the house right near the forest. So, and that's how I used to do when we pick up little berries in the street and we take a tall grass and we stain them through the grass because we have nothing to carry them. That's how we carry the berries in the woods.
Oh, I see. So that's how you get them back to the house.
Back to the house. So you tie them together on the end, and that's how you bring to the house.
Oh, wonderful. And the next picture is of your entire family.
It's
immediate family.
Trust me, this is only half of them. This is only half of them. So it's my mom's sisters, my cousins, their husbands, there's some children. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this is typical Sunday.
Yeah.
And it's my another cousin, Olga, she's in the very back over there. That's her house.
And we do know, or you do know, that some of your relatives have made it out of Ukraine. And I think this next picture.
So these two, the Olga and my sister Natalia. So I don't know how the best to describe it, or I forced them or I begged them, because I did both. When everything started, because they have the youngest children, and I just begged and forced them to leave. So because of all this bombing going on, they have to be in shelters and everything, they kind of listen. Mm-hmm. So the guys take them to the border and they had to cross it, and they pack just literally one bag each, the most, like, it's basically documents and couple clothes.
And the next one is
the children. Victoria and Dennis.
Yes. And they are in, is it Hungary?
This picture was taken in Hungary, yes. That's when these people from a village came to brought the kids some presents, like some juices, desserts, like some stuff, because the woman that in the hotel that they stay, it's like a little breakfast and bed and breakfast. So the woman told people at the church that she has a couple of refugees or whatever, so people on Sunday came and give them, they made their day a little bit, so that's why they're all smiling.
Yeah, well, I also notice he's making the V for victory sign.
Yes.
Good for him. So one of the things that we've heard in this country is Mr. Putin has said that Ukraine isn't a country, and I want to quote exactly what he said. In a speech, he said, "Ukraine has never had its own authentic statehood. There has never been a sustainable statehood in Ukraine." What would you and the people of Ukraine say to that? And remember, this is a church.
He can be so far from a truth. So far from a truth, because, like, I also know that he mentioned that our country is not even 10 years old or whatever. Like, I am 44 years old, and I've been speaking Ukrainian all my life. All my life, it was only Ukrainian language for me. So we always knew that's how I grew up. When I grew up, it was Ukraine, and Ukraine, of course. It was a part of Soviet Union. We know about Russia and everything. But answering the question to him, I printed, because, like, again, you know, you learn history in Ukraine in school and everything, but it's like, again, you move on, you have a life, you have a work and children, so you always know that Ukraine is a country, but if somebody makes a statement like that, so you go to the books and internet and mm-hmm. you start to, like, Google it again.
Yes.
And so I printed this picture. This is the man in 1648, the first Ukrainian president who created Ukraine, not just the territories, but Ukraine was recognized as a political, territorial, and a government. So his name is Bohdan Khmelnytsky. He was the army general. And of course, back then in 17th centuries, 15th centuries, the land and countries in Europe was sustained as a, like, territory that was people owned privately, people fight for it, they took a territory, they created their spaces. So he was the one that the first, he was signed Ukraine as a Ukraine with the borders, territories, government, and political.
Yeah.
So since then, Ukraine was always fight for the freedom. They were always want to be recognized between mm-hmm. all the territories in Europe and everything. So in each books, like a German books, English books and everything, they from 1648, that's when Ukraine was established as Ukraine. Mm-hmm. And believe or not, the Russia was not, because they were called Ukraine Rus. Rus uh-huh. is a Russian. So when Russians came as a Russian, when they started to establish, Ukrainian did not want to associate with the word Rus. That's how they dropped it uh-huh. and how Russians adopted. Mm-hmm. But before, it was not Russian as whatever, it was Ukraine Rus. Mm-hmm. So.
And we in this country have been so amazed and inspired by the bravery of the Ukrainian army, the troops, and everyday people. I mean, we've seen the pictures of people in town standing in front of Russian tanks. Does that surprise you?
No, not at all, especially after this Orange Revolution 8 years ago. After this, Ukraine and Ukrainian people would not take any back, because give up right now, it's mean have the people that lost their lives 8 years ago during the Orange Revolution, and I believe it was around 130 people that lost a life and thousands were wounded, and it's mean betray them, you know, betray their memory, betray this 3 months in the winter in January that started, you know, when they stood up and fight to overturn a government and go back to west of Ukraine, not the east of Ukraine. So this will be big failure for Ukrainians. No, yeah. they would never step down. Yeah.
Very patriotic. And I did a little bit of research and came across the Ukrainian national anthem. And there were two lines in particular that made me realize that Mr. Putin has his hands full. These are the two lines in the Ukrainian anthem. The glory and freedom of Ukraine has not yet perished. And then the second line, will not spare either our souls or bodies for freedom. And I wonder if you would do us the honor of I won't make you sing it, but would you say the...
Trust me, you would not make to sing, it will be empty.
Would you do us the honor of saying the words to your national anthem in Ukrainian?
I just want to give you the little preview about national anthem. When Mr. Putin saying that Ukraine was not whatever, but our national anthem was written in 1862. So how can you say that Ukraine was not the country and we did not fight for our freedom and we did not want to be recognized when the words to the national anthem was written in 1862 by Pavel Chubinsky? So, just in Ukrainian.
Yes, please. I think it's a beautiful language.
Ще не вмерла Україна, ні слава, ні воля, ще нам, браття молоді, усміхнеться доля. Згинуть наші вороженьки, як роса на сонці, запануєм і ми, браття, у нашій сторонці.
Thank you. And something tells me, based upon you being here this morning, and it's part of your determination to do whatever you can to help your country. So even though you came all the way up from Marston Mills, and hopefully you're not as nervous now, but it tells me that no matter what happens, the Ukrainian people will never stop fighting.
I don't think so. As much as I know people, and I am representing the 40 million of Ukrainians, and also 10 million that live outside of Ukraine. We are strongly, with all our hearts, with Ukrainian people, and no, they would not give up. Not at this point. They went too far. We tasted the freedom. We tasted the life, and this is not the way that we're gonna go. No.
Yeah. And the big question that many of us, millions of us in this country are asking ourselves is, what can we do to support the Ukrainian people?
It's two things. Two things that the internet, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram been flooding with. And maybe it's a little, cheesy or whatever, but first one, people ask for the prayers. Everybody, whoever I talk to, if I text my friends, if I call my friends or families or whatever, all of them are gonna swear to this. They asking, pray for us. Just pray for us. And the second thing, they asking not for themselves, they asking for their children and elderly parents, closest guys. We've been signing petitions online to the governments and everything. Closing the skies, it means to Ukrainians as prayers. Because the middle-aged people can fight for themselves, they survive. But the innocent children and innocent older people, they just can't. And it's not enough support, it's not enough roads, because they're bombing the roads that the people have been evacuating through. And it's just closing the skies, that would mean a lot. It means that they can do the fair fight.
Mm-hmm. So, absolutely.
These two things that every Ukrainian is asking for.
Thank you. Well, on behalf of our entire congregation, I want to thank you for being here. I have a few brief words that I'm going to say, but our hearts are breaking for all of your people.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So over the course of the last few weeks, as we've watched the horrible evil that is being inflicted on the Ukrainian people, I found the Spirit leading me to two passages in Scripture. The first one you'll find in the book of Proverbs, And I'm going to ask you all to stand for a moment and to say it with me. There are six things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that make haste to run to evil, a false witness who breathes out lies, and one who sows discord among brothers. Please be seated. That passage from Proverbs makes it absolutely clear that our God is a righteous judge who will not hold guiltless those who are evil and do evil things. So if I were Mr. Putin, I would be very afraid. Not just right now, but even more so for the day when it comes time for him to meet his maker. The other passage of scripture you'll find in Luke's gospel. We read in the 19th chapter, beginning with the 41st verse. And when Jesus drew near and saw the city of Jerusalem, he wept over it, saying, "Would that even now you had known the things that make for peace, but they are hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down to the ground." Jesus then entered the temple and began to drive out those who sold, saying to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be a house of prayer,' but you have made it into a den of robbers." And he was teaching daily in the temple. At first glance, the two things that Jesus did that day just don't seem to go together. The first thing he did was stand on a hill overlooking Jerusalem. And as he wept, he cried out, "Would that even now you knew the things that make for peace." Then immediately after that, he stormed into the temple. And after he overturned the tables, he drove the money changers out of the temple. Again, those two things don't seem to go together. Until the Spirit of Wisdom whispered to me, and I suddenly realized that if we want peace for the people of Ukraine and peace everywhere, we need to do both of the things that Jesus did that day. The first thing you need to do is let the suffering of the Ukrainian people fill your hearts with sadness. But you can't stay there in the sadness. If you do, it will eventually overwhelm you. It will leave you feeling helpless and hopeless. That's why it's so important to do the second thing that Jesus did that day. You let the sadness for the suffering of the Ukrainian people fill your heart with righteous indignation, the same righteous indignation that led Jesus to drive the money changers out of the temple. So, good people, my sisters and brothers, I invite you to do this. I beg you to do it. The next time you go and fill up your gas tank, instead of complaining about how expensive it is, let that fill your heart with righteous indignation, so that you say to yourself, "If this is the price that I have to pay to make sure that good overcomes evil, then that's what I'm going to do." And let that righteous indignation lead you to this question: what else can I do? What other sacrifice can I make that will bring peace to the Ukrainian people? They are already sacrificing so much. And remember this. When you sacrifice for others out of a spirit of love, you're doing the same thing that Jesus did on that cross when he laid down his life for us. Your English is better than my Ukrainian. Hospodi blahoslovi Ukrainu. God bless Ukraine. So as we prepare to receive the offering this morning, a brief announcement, and our offering is going to be added and combined with donations that are being received from customers at a China cuisine restaurant. Our thanks to Victor and Mei Hui. And they are matching all donations up to $20,000. And so I am pleased to say that this morning we will be receiving and dedicating a gift from both our members and the customers of China Cuisine in the amount of $3,389. This will be going on the entire month. And Arena, I would ask that you do the honor of putting this in the offering plate on behalf of your people.
Thank you. Thank you.
in the prayer of dedication. We bring you this offering, Holy One, in the name of the Prince of Peace, and pray that it will bring healing and hope to your Ukrainian children, wherever they may be. Guide us with the light of your truth and grace, that we may also go forth to be instruments of your peace. This we pray in the name of the living Christ, who laid down his life for us. Amen.
Please be seated. So, Arena, the closing hymn this morning is one that is near and dear to many of our hearts. It's very special in our country. It is, "Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord," also known as the Battle Hymn of the Republic. It was sung by Union forces during the Civil War, and they sang it as they went to stand up to the evil of slavery in our country. This morning, let us sing it on behalf of the Ukrainian people. People of God, our service of worship has ended. Let us prepare to go forth wherever we may be to continue our service of love, knowing that our God goes before us. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Creator Christ, and Holy Spirit be upon you all. Amen. Remind everyone that we will gather up in Fellowship Hall.